Sister Marie was there. It started at 5:30 and long about 8:30. They still had not given me what they wanted to recognize me with. You know, when it gets dark, I start getting sleepy. Amen.
Amen.
So, 5:30, about 8:45, I exit stage left, and they'll have to get it to me another time. But I am appreciative. Amen. Amen. Thank God for the word this morning. I know you have your Bibles, and I want to call us to the book of the beginning. We're going to go to Genesis this morning, chapter 32, and look together at a very familiar narrative in the life of one of the patriarchs of the Old Testament. Genesis 32, beginning with verse 24. The Bible says, "Then Jacob was left alone. The man wrestled with him until daybreak. When he saw that he had not prevailed against him, he touched the socket of his thigh, so that the socket of Jacob's thigh was dislocated while he wrestled with him. Then he said, 'Let me go, for the dawn is breaking.' But he said, 'I will not let you go unless you bless me.' So he said to him, 'What is your name?' And he said, 'Jacob.' He said, 'Your name shall no longer be Jacob, but Israel. You have striven with God and with men and has prevailed.'" And then verse 29, "Then Jacob asked him and said, 'Please tell me your name.' He said, 'Why is it that you ask my name?' And he blessed him there. So Jacob named the place Peniel, for he said, 'I have seen God face to face, yet my life has been preserved.'" If you'll be seated within this wonderful pericopean narrative of Jacob, patriarch, verse 26, "Then he said, 'Let me go, for the dawn is breaking.' He said, 'I will not let you go unless you bless me.'" How bad do you want it? How bad do you want it? And many of us, as a matter of fact, it has really become one of the prominent emphases within Christianity today, and that is this idea of being blessed. Persons seek, often come to worship, not merely to bless the Lord, but to be blessed themselves. Sometimes we get it out of order because the psalmist says, I believe in Psalm 103, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name." But yet, we don't come to bless the Lord. We come because we're seeking to be blessed. Ask any individual how they're doing, their response will be, "I'm blessed and I'm highly favored." There's nothing wrong with the child of God wanting to be blessed. As a matter of fact, I want you to know you were blessed before you even arrived on earth. Because the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 1 that we were blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Not simply when we came to Christ, but those blessings were already waiting in store for us in eternity past, before God ever formed the world. And what we see, the riches of God were already in existence, ready to be lavished on someone, but there was nobody to lavish his blessings on, so he spoke one day and the world was created. So understand, the blessings were here before you arrived. Jeremiah the prophet, when he was called, the Lord told him that, "I called and I blessed you before you ever formed in your mother's womb." There's nothing wrong with wanting to be blessed, but we need to understand what to be blessed means. And this text helps us to understand that to be blessed has nothing to do with what's in your hand. It has to do with whose hand is on you. They're going to say it again. The idea of being blessed has nothing to do with what is in your hand. It has to do with whose hand is on you. Because if the right hand is on you, the treasures that flow from that hand automatically accrue to those whose his hands are already on. Y'all miss that. You need to understand, it's not your finances, it's not what you possess in your hand that qualifies you as being blessed by the Lord. What makes you blessed of the Lord is when the Lord has his hand on you. And when the Lord has his hand on you, you need to understand, God does not withhold anything. from those who have surrendered and sold themselves out to him. Listen, my brothers and sisters, we need to understand that being blessed is simply being touched by the hand of God. There was a peasant that was frequently going before a king asking for certain favors. And one day the peasant went to the king and said, "King, I know that I'm before your presence very often asking for favors, but I'm here today asking for a large favor." The king was somewhat worn out and exasperated because this peasant was wearing him out by his continual coming. So in frustration, the king finally said, "When will you stop begging?" The gentleman thought for a moment and said, "I'll stop begging when you stop giving." And I want you to understand something, my brothers and sisters, we serve a God who keeps on giving over and over and over again. And all he wants us to do is come and ask him for what we need. And we need to understand that God loves us to praise and to bless his holy name. And many of us want God to simply give it to us when we give him a 1 minute prayer or a 2 minute prayer. Or we pay attention for 15 minutes in worship. But God wants the consumption of our mind. He wants us fully devoted and committed to him. And I want you to understand, when we focus on him, God said, "I'll never quit giving."
Amen.
You just need to keep on asking. Manly Beasley, one of the founders of Baptist tradition in Europe, Manly Beasley would often greet people by not simply saying hello, but he would go up to people and say, "What are you trusting God for today?" And that's a very deep greeting to go up to folk. And Christians ought to go up to one another, even as they come and worship, and ask, "What is it that you are trusting God for today? What are your expectations of God today?" See, many of us, we live on spiritual neutral. We only want God when a crisis arises. And so whenever nothing's going on in our life, so we think, we just put it in neutral. We don't talk to him. We don't call on his name. We just sit in spiritual neutral, just gliding through life. But then when we hit a rough part in the road like Jacob, we want to put it in overdrive and expect God, when we've been in neutral, to all of a sudden bless us when we put it in overdrive. Need of desperation. But listen, if we would be rolling with the Lord all the time, keeping company with the Lord, talking to him, even when we don't want nothing, we would understand that God would be blessing us all the way. I want you to know God has the power to meet us at the point of your need. As a matter of fact, God will meet you at the point of your need. We find Jacob, my brothers and sisters, here in our text. He meets God at his point of need. The first thing we notice in this text, we notice something about the power of desperation. It says Jacob was left alone. When you get alone in a crisis, you get desperate. He was left alone and he wrestled with a man, an Old Testament appearance of the Lord. When he saw that he could not prevail and he was injured, he just continued to wrestle. I want you to know something, my brothers and sisters. You will find your breakthrough in your brokenness.
Yeah.
And many of us don't understand that we want to get to the other side, but you can't get to the other side by avoiding what's in your way.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, you've got to go through it with God in order to get what's on the other side. And my brothers and sisters, only when we become desperate enough like Jacob can we be blessed even in our brokenness.
Amen.
Now listen, Jacob was a master of maneuvering. He could wrestle, he could squirm and wiggle his way out of anything. The name Jacob literally means trickster. He could talk his way out of a situation. If he got back in a corner, he could wiggle, he could connive, he could maneuver to get himself out of situations that he's hemmed in. And many of us, the reason why we don't call on the Lord is because we think we can wiggle and squirm and get ourselves out of situations we are in, and we don't need God. But the fact of the matter is, we all wind up being in situations like Jacob, between a rock and a hard place. Listen, Jacob was a maneuvering, conniving trickster. One day he found himself in a tight corner. Life literally caught up with Jacob. and Jacob wasn't slick enough to slip out of God's hold. And if you want to understand the situation that Jacob was in, you got to go back to chapter 28 and then move up to chapter 31. Because you'll find, my brothers and sisters, that Jacob, the maneuverer, the trickster, he tricked his brother Esau out of his birthright. And when Esau found out, Esau said, when I find my brother, somebody talk to me. He said, when I find my brother's going to regret the day he ever was born. So Jacob, after he maneuvered and tricked, he wiggled and squirmed his way out of it by literally running. His mama helped him to pack and run and say, look, I want you to go stay with my brother, your uncle Laban. So he ran from Esau to Laban. When he got close to Laban's house, the Bible says he stopped at a well. At the well, he saw the most beautiful woman he had ever seen by the name of Rachel. He said, I want to stay here. Where's your daddy? Where's my uncle? So he went to the uncle and said, look, I'll give you anything if you just give me Rachel. The old man said, I'll tell you what, work for me 7 years. He worked for him 7 years. It came time for the wedding. And during the time of the wedding, listen, the veil was over the woman. You couldn't take the veil off until y'all went in to consummate the marriage. Somebody talk to me in this place. It wasn't no kiss at the altar. Y'all had to wait until y'all went somewhere. So when he got to consummate the marriage and raise the veil, he realized it was not Rachel, it was her sister. He said, wait a minute, I'm the trickster. I done got tricked. So he went back to Laban and said, you have tricked me. I ran from Esau, now I ran to you. You didn't trick me. He said, work for me 7 more years. He worked 7 more years. That's 14 years in order to get the woman that he loved. But then he stayed 6 more years, 20 years, working. And during those 6 years, he was tricked by Laban. Laban said, I'm going to pay you so-and-so wages. But he didn't pay him what he promised to pay. So for 20 years, he was getting tricked by Laban. So he got so upset with Laban, and the Lord blessed him. The Lord said, it ain't right what he did to you, Jacob, even though it was your come even more. So I tell you what, you can take your two wives and the extras that you've got along, because he got some concubines as well. He said, I want y'all to go and go back to the land of Canaan. And when he left, Laban went to run after him. And when Laban went to run after him, notice what happened. He ran from Esau to run to Laban. Now he's running from Laban and back to run back into Esau. Listen, I want you to know something. You can run from God all you want. But like Jacob, he ran from one thing to something else. Then he wound up running from that right back into what he left. You can't avoid it. You got to go through it in order to get to the other side. So here's where Jacob reached his moment of desperation. He turns and looks back. And if he goes back, he's going back to Laban, who's going to get him. If he keeps going forward, he's going to run into Esau, who's sure enough going to get him. That's a tight spot. That's being between a rock and a hard place. When you can't go back and you can't go forward, so all you can do is stop and look up unto the hills from which cometh your help. And that's how God sovereignly orchestrates the situations in our life. We'd rather go forward, go back, than to look up. So God will make the look back and the look forward so unappealing that we get desperate enough to call upon God so that God can fix it. David was between a rock and a hard place, and he got to this point of desperation. You need to understand that blessing can't come without wrestling. As a matter of fact, desperation always precedes illumination, because most of us never seek God until we are forced to seek God. And so God puts us at a point of desperation so he can get our attention. Listen, I know you can look in your life and know a lot of times you're going along in life, but as soon as you get to that desperate point in your life, God has your unequivocal attention. You praying like you ain't never prayed before. You praying earnestly. You praying morning, noon, and night. You praying so hard. Matter of fact, you praying so hard that you feel like you can call down rain from heaven. David, at this point, we see the power of desperation. And the power of desperation, my friends, leads you to our second point. That's the power of persistence. Verses 26 to 28, the Bible says that Jacob says, I'm not going to let you go unless you bless me. I want you to know something. Persistence only comes after we reach our desperate moment. But we need to understand, when we work, we work. But when we pray, God works.
All right.
And many of us, we are exhausted, we are worn out because we're trying to work, but we won't take it to the Lord.
Woo.
You can work all you want to work, but when you pray, God does all the work.
Amen.
Matter of fact, a child of God can only move forward on his or her knees. We don't move forward by putting one step in front of another. A child of God only moves forward on our knees. When we fall on our knees and call out to the Lord knows that we're in a position where we're literally ready to move forward. So we need to understand the way out is the way down. You got to fall on your knees, prostrate yourself before the Lord. Say, Lord, ain't nothing else going to work. That woman who had an issue of blood, she fell down on her knees and she reached out and touched the hem of his garment. And when she touched his garment, she realized he had a hospital in his hem. I didn't need to be spending all my money on these folks who can't fix nothing. I need to get to the one who can fix it right now. Power of persistence is important. I want you to understand, a prayer environment is the breakthrough in your life. Listen, when your heart's desperation exceeds your desperate condition, you will be at a moment where God is ready to bless you. But for many of us, our heart's desire and our heart's desperation has not exceeded our desperate condition. But I don't know about you, I've been in situations in my life, and you might as well admit it yourself, where your situation was so desperate and your heart was so full that the desperation of your heart rose above your desperate situation and you called out to the Lord in prayer. And so we find Jacob was so desperate that he earnestly sought the Lord. And in the Bible, when it talks about earnestly praying, that means that we pray in our prayers. That's what that word earnest means. It means to pray in your prayers. See, sometimes we don't pray in our prayers. We just say our prayers. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep my eye out loud and fall asleep. And don't even get to amen. Somebody talk to me in this place. Simply saying your prayers, but in your desperate situation and you become persistent, you don't say, now I lay me down to sleep. You say, Father, I stretch my hands to thee. No other help I know. If thou withdraw thyself from me, whither shall I go? That's earnestly praying in your prayers. See, you gotta learn how to talk to the Lord and not simply go through the routine of religious language. You got to know how to call on him and get an answer from heaven. Lord teaches us who to pray to and teaches us that we ought to pray in problems, we ought to pray in pleasure, and we ought to pray in pain. Thomas Watson said that prayer is the key of heaven and faith is the hand that turns it. Listen, my brothers and sisters, we need to understand that God wants us to understand that persistence, it's like that stone cutter who's hammering away at a rock. And that stone cutter hammers and hammers and hammers literally 100 times without seeing literally a crack in the stone. But on that 101st hammer, the stone splits in two. And I want you to understand something. It was not that 101st blow that made it split in two. It was those first 100 blows that led to it breaking open on 101. And so you may have called on God 99 times and may not see your blessing. But I want you to know whatever you do before is going to lead to what you get in the end. So don't give up on God, because persistence in calling on the name of the Lord will lead to what you are looking for. Jacob is at this moment where we see the power of desperation, the moment where we see the power of persistence. But then lastly, we see in verses 29 through 30, we see the power of surrender and abandonment. The Bible says that Jacob
came to a place called Peniel. That literally means face of God. And Jacob, he came face to face with God. And when he came face to face with God, Manly Beasley says that a glimpse of Jesus will save you, but a gaze at him will sanctify you. And a lot of us, we want to give him a glimpse, but not a glaze. Somebody talk to me in this place. We want to get a glimpse of his glory, but we don't want to gaze and bask in his glory. Listen, the Lord is not a part-time lover, and he don't want no part-time worshipers. We want a glimpse at him when they get in trouble. We want to get a glimpse behind the shade whenever they want to get out of a predicament. He don't need no window shopper blessings. He wants them that want to gaze and bask in his glory morning, noon, and night. And when the Lord knows that, we want to gaze on the beauty of his holiness. The Lord will bless you. Listen, when a man or a woman, when they get desperate enough for God, I want you to know they can get through to God. God blessed Jacob at the point of his surrender and the point of his abandonment. And I want you to know something. Andrew Murray said that God is ready to assume full responsibility for the life that is totally yielded to him. And you need to understand something. As Jacob was running from Esau and ran into Laban, and then ran from Laban and was running back to Esau, you need to understand, we can't outrun whatever we are going through. We can't avoid it. We got to stand there and face it. But the good news is, we don't have to face it all by ourselves. We can face it with God. And understand, through your progression of wrestling, you'll find that when the Lord knows that you have the stick-to-itiveness to stay with him through the storm and through the rain, the Lord will bless you in the midst of your storm. But you've got to hold to God's unchanging hand. You've got to trust and never doubt that God will bring you out. You've got to bring your burdens to the Lord and leave them there. When you find yourself at your penial moment and come face to face with God, you've got to glory in the face of God and take your mind off the condition. Because when you take your mind off the condition, you'll experience mountain moving faith. And mountain moving faith does not focus on the mountain. It focuses on the God of the mountain. That's why you gotta lift your eyes above the mountain to the God who sits on the land and on the sea. You gotta look to the God that will meet you face to face and bless you in the midst of your storm. Listen, it might be raining and might be pouring in your life, but God will be a fence all around. Andrew Murray said, is ready to assume full responsibility. responsibility for any heart that is totally yielded unto you. Listen, you're at your moment. Your moment of desperation. Also your moment of persistence. But your breakthrough, and by breakthrough I mean what brings you from darkness of a life of sin into the marvelous and wonderful light of God's provision of grace given through Christ on the cross, can only come when you yield and abandon yourself of self and give yourself totally to the Savior who hung, bled, and died on the cross for you. As we stand and as deacons come and as we as ministers make ready to do a great and wonderful privilege, and that is through the proclamation of the word, to simply make a request and an appeal. Those who are yet living in darkness would come and give us your hand, give God your heart, and make a public confession.